New team. Pop Warner sat in Richard Henry Pratt's office at the Carlisle School. He watched Pratt's face for a reaction to what he had just said. The man didn't even blink. Wanting the job badly, but hoping not to appear overeager, he had just delivered a list of demands, including a salary of $1,200 plus expenses. If Pratt was shocked, he didn't show it. He had done his homework, asking around about the best young coaches. Here he knew he wanted Warner. The salary was absurdly high, among the highest of any coach in the nation. But still, Pratt figured, it might be a sound investment. The football team was already earning positive press. Imagine if they actually started winning. Wins would bring bigger crowds. Bigger crowds would mean more money for Carlisle, which took home a share of ticket sales. Pratt was constantly struggling to raise donations and pry cash from Congress for his school. A fresh source of income would be most welcome. Pratt reached across the desk to offer Warner his hand. Feeling more financially secure than he ever had, Warner married his childhood sweetheart, Tib Lorraine Smith, and they moved together to a small cottage on the Carlisle campus. When the 1899 school year began in September, the coach walked onto Indian Field to meet his new team. His career at Carlisle nearly ended the same week.
"Having been coached by some rather hard-boiled gents during my days as a player," Warner later explained, "I took a fairly extensive vocabulary with me to Carlisle, and I made full use of it."
A polite way of saying he cursed up a storm on the practice field.
"Play football!" he screamed. "What in the do you think you're doing?"
Warner saw it as a way of motivating his guys. The player saw it as unnecessary and offensive. A couple of the best athletes stopped coming to practice. Every day, fewer and fewer players showed up. Warner would see the men on campus during the day. He knew they were still at school. He stopped one shouting,
"You haven't been to practice in 2 days.
I'm tired of you coming to practice every day and listening to your swearing every time I make a mistake. I've had it." Warner hadn't realized what the problem was.
"If you'll come back," he said, "I'll never swear at you or anyone again."
The players came back. Warner promised to tone down his language, and he did, for a while. Finally, they got to work. While his team drilled, Pop strolled the field with a whistle around his neck, smoke rising from a cigarette between his lips. He studied the players' strengths, watched for weaknesses.
"I had all the prejudice of the average white," he later admit. "I used to read that Indians would always quit if they didn't win a fight at the very onset."
That was wrong, Warner quickly realized. Dead wrong. These guys had lost plenty, not only on the football field. Most came from families that endured decades of attacks and upheaval. They were far from home, stuck at a school designed to erase their essential part of who they were. But here on the field, there was a fire in their eyes. They were wide open to new ideas, quick to absorb information. When Pop wanted to show the players a new player technique, he gathered them around and drew it on a blackboard. They only had to see it once. The one thing that still bothered Warner was the team's lack of size. Bemis Pierce had graduated and was coaching football at the University of Buffalo. Even with Holly Pierce still in action, the team was going to be badly outweighed by the top schools. They were quick, but how much would that help?
"Speed had little place in a team's offense attack,"
Warner said of early day football.
"Big human mountains were sought and valued by every coach, and it didn't matter if the behemoths could navigate slowly or swiftly."
Could a team succeed without behemoths? None ever had. But that didn't mean it couldn't be done. Frank Hudson had already figured this out. Born in a Pueblo village in New Mexico, Hudson had set out to Carlisle when he was just 9. He was a studious, serious boy who learned to set type in the printing shop and worked on the school newspaper. He was serious about football, too. Often referred to in articles as the Little Indian Quarterback, the 5'5 Hudson used speed and quick thinking to transform himself from bony teen into elite player. He also saw a scoring opportunity that wasn't always being used to its potential. Field goals were worth 5 points, the same as touchdowns, which rule makers had just increased in value from 4 to 5. At the time, the standard way to kick a field goal was the drop kick. The kicker literally dropped the ball on the ground in front of him, let it bounce, and kicked it as it rose. The fat ball bounced fairly predictably. The kicking part was the problem. Airborne, the ball wobbled and swerved, and field goal tries of more than 30 yards were crapshoots. Hudson thought he could do better. Night after night, he stayed after practice, drop-kicking the ball toward, and sometimes through the goalposts on Indian fields. On winter evenings, he practiced in the gym, aiming at goalposts he built from the gymnastic bars. Now in his last year at Carlisle, Hudson showed the new coach that he could drop-kick consistently from 40 yards out, with either foot. Warner was not one to gush praise, at least not in front of his players.
"Okay, son," he told Hudson, "that'll do nicely."
At home, he gushed.
"This is a new kind of team," Pop told Tib one evening after dinner. "They're light, but they're fast and jerky. Once they get into an open field, they're like acrobats. They're so hard to knock off their feet. And proud. It's just like the kind of team I've always dreamed of coaching."
With the first game of the season approaching, Warner continued shifting players around, trying different combinations on the line and in the backfield. He worked the team hard, hammering away at tackling technique and the proper way to block bigger men.
The Indians took to it like ducks to water,
Pop would later explain.
And when they blocked a man, he stayed blocked.
On rare occasions when a player wasn't aggressive enough for Pop's liking, he'd line up opposite the offender and demand better.
Now get here, he'd grunt. Show me how it should be done.
When he challenged a Cherokee lineman named James Phillips, Phillips burst forward with such force he knocked Pop unconscious. Everyone stopped and watched the coach. After a few moments, Warner sat up. He looked at Phillips and said,
Now that's the way it's done.
Another day at practice, Warner gathered the team.
When you're on defense and the other team starts to play, in which they all move to your right, what do?
Slide along to the right with them, Martin Wheelock answered.
Find the ball carrier and dive in.
Right, it's only natural, Warner said.
Okay, you men, line up over there.
The starters lined up on defense. Warner huddled his second teamers on offense and described a variation of the old number 39 play. The offense snapped the ball and the entire line drove left, and the ball carrier followed. Once the momentum of the play was moving in that direction, the man with the ball stopped, turned, and raced to the right. He sprinted untouched all the way to the goal line.
Get the other team moving in one direction,
Warner lectured,
so that your ball carrier can go the other.
Carlisle practiced it over and over. They added an additional wrinkle. The ball carrier, say, started to his left. Then, instead of reversing direction himself, he pitched the ball to a teammate who was already running to the right. A reverse, as it's now known. Warner and the team agreed to save it for just the right occasion. The team cruised to a 21-0 win in the season opener against Gettysburg College. No need to get creative the following week either, as Carlisle walloped Susquehanna University 56-0. Then things got serious. Next on the schedule was the first Big Four challenge of the Pop Warner era, the University of Pennsylvania. Penn had been absurdly dominant over the last five seasons, compiling a record of 67-2. They outscored Carlisle 112-15 in four blowout victories. They were overwhelming favorites to win easy again. That was fine with Pop Warner. He knew Carlisle's record so far against the Big Four was 0-12, but he also knew his players were more than hungry. He knew they were starting to click as a team, and they were a lot better than anyone on the Carlisle campus realized.